has become a really huge advantage because I have been dictating the book. And not all of it. I mean, I still have to go back after she types it up and then I, like, you know, have to add stuff. But I figured out that if I'm not looking at it, I can get a lot more words quickly because I'm not I can't edit it. Because she won't, you know, she'll only read back, like, two sentences. Like, if I'm, like, I'm really old. I'll be like, I totally forgot what I was talking about. And she'll read, like, two sentences. And it's like, that's it. Keep going. Because if I start going back, then I'll be like, we should change this. Or, like, you know what I mean? It's just, and then all of the time that you're supposed to be working is sucked up with you messing around. It's just another procrastination strategy. It's like you're fixing the book or you're, like, I did spend a lot of time reformatting this book before I turned it in because it was late. So I changed the margins a whole bunch of times until I got exactly the number of pages that I needed. And my agent didn't say anything. I'm not really sure. I think she probably knew, but my editor said, "Oh my gosh, it's so weird. There's the margins are so huge." It was literally, it looked like a picture frame. There's all this white around and then the book in the middle. But I got like 16 pages out of it. And another trick, this is a really good one. I can't remember who told me this, maybe Melissa De La Cruz. But if you're in your document, right, and let's say you have two sentences left, and then the chapter ends, you add another two, because then you'll get a whole page when the next line kicks down. You get a whole page out of that. Yeah. You do that like 7, 8, 9 times, that's 10 pages. Yeah. Just saying. So I did that, like, and she was like, you know, and every single chapter ends on like a single line on its own page. And I was like, that's so weird. It must mean something. Like, maybe that's good luck. But she thought it was weird that in book two, the margins had changed back to normal, and I said, "Oh, I'm using Scrivener. I don't know how to work it." Or I blame it on Chloe. I'll be like, "Chloe is a better typist than me. She does weird stuff to the margins. Like, I can change the back." She's like, "No, we prefer it when there's words on the page." So, but I'm not kidding. Like, I don't know if it was Chloe or my friend Erin who works for me sometimes, and she was like, "You don't think they're gonna notice? Like, you don't think anybody's ever done that before?" Like, all of Little Brown. And I was like, I don't care how many people have done it. Mm-hmm. As long as it gets turned in and no one says anything before midnight, I turned it in. They can all figure it out the next day and we can have a big conference call about it. But as far as I'm concerned, if I turn that thing in by midnight, I have the right number of pages, I'm done.
So your contract says the number of pages you're supposed
to turn in. No, but everyone knows that I refuse to adhere to word count. I didn't know, Margie and I didn't know what the word count was on Beautiful Creatures until Cassie Claire asked us in a chat after it was published.
Oh my God.
I don't do word count, I do pages. Okay. Because, so I work in pages. I'm sure my contract has a word count in it. I just don't care what it is. Yeah. obviously, with Beautiful Creatures, as I told them, I feel it's like sick days. I'm like, I think we've banked some. You know, we definitely wrote more than 70,000 words for Beautiful Creatures. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's 158,000. So I was like, because Cassie was like, it can't be longer than, you know, City of Bones. Somebody said that in the chat, and Cassie was like, how many words is it? And I was like, I don't know. And she was like, okay, go under format. Like, we did this whole thing, like, while I was, and I figured it out. And so I just, like, I figure, you know, it's like an IOU. They owe me roughly, I don't know, 120,000 words. That's the strategy I'm going with. It's working right now.
The Slayer.
Right. See? I got, oh my gosh, I don't know if any of you have ever seen this. My dogs are named Spike and Oz. I take Buffy very seriously. And last night I was with Amber Benson, who was really sad she could not be here to thank you guys. She really wanted to come. And I got, you know, the commemorative, I bought myself the commemorative box with the steak in it.
Oh, nice. Very nice.
With a really classy, nice, like, Buffy photo montage on the box. Before you open up your box, it says, like, you know, the Slayer Creed, and then there's a big, I'm assuming it's probably resin. Although I think I could kill an intruder with it if I had to. It's huge. And it's very pointy, and it looks like big wood, and I love it. Awesome. I love it almost as much as I love my Supernatural bag that I got from Comic-Con.
Oh, neat.
Yeah, but I had to buy online because my editors, my publicist said, I will get you one, and then when she went to get me one, it had been long gone.
Of course.
And no one would trade me theirs for my weird Batman one. So I was like, I'll buy it online like everything else.
Of course.
It's true.
I bought a Harry Potter wand. That's my geeky
thing. I bought that for my son.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Did you buy the one, like, from the movie?
Yeah, well, it's the kind that if you hit it once, it lights up. You hit it again, the light goes off.
I don't know. I'm not allowed to touch it. It has a box.
Does it have a box? It has a box. But the great thing about it is the tip lights up.
Very cool.
It's really
I don't know. My son, it came in a very fancy box, and he was like, you're not allowed to touch it. It's mine. It's very fragile.
It's not fragile.
Oh, okay. Well, that's my son's way of getting me not touch stuff. It's telling me it's fragile. Like all of his Star Wars and... I was like, I can help you put it together. He's like, don't touch it, it's fragile.
Do you break things a lot?
No, that's the thing. I mean, I hurt myself a lot. I injure myself a lot. But I don't break, no, not at all. And quite frankly, like, I have a lot of fragile stuff in my house, which is not broken. I think, I don't know, I just don't think he trusts me, especially with his, like, he likes Star Wars and he likes Harry Potter. And that's it. So... You know, there's like big Millennium Falcon made of Legos. I did break one Star Lego thing.
Lego.
But I put it back together. And in my defense, it was not assembled properly. I think my husband was messing around with it because it was like one of those things where it's supposed to open. But when you tried to open it, it like fell apart. And I don't even think he was around though when I broke it. And I fixed, you know, just like in those, what are they called? Those Charlie and Lola books. I totally fixed it up before he came home. You know, that's what you have to do if you break your shoulder and stuff. Anybody else? Is anyone interested in writing?
Ah. Ooh, we've got like four.
You don't have any writing questions?
Four.
I find that hard to believe.
I think of any.
No? She's like, I don't want to ask you guys.
You're
going to
think of
me.
Like 10 of them. Later on tonight, it's going to be
awesome. He's more of the huge shy type, so. Yeah.
You should whisper them to him and then make him ask
them. Yeah, think of anything while I'm here, like...
In the moment.
In a book signing, and then I leave. And I'm like, damn it, I should have asked.
Last night, they got to ask, like, flash questions. And someone asked if we were going to have a superpower, what would it be? And Marie Lou said, my superpower would be to go back in time 1 hour so that I could, like, think about everything that was said and then say something cooler in the redo, which is hilarious. And it's the same thing. Like, you could go back in time, and then, like, you would think of all the questions, and you could go back and ask them all. Yeah. So I want to know, what would your superpower be?
Well, it's, you know, I've got the boring one that everybody wants, the one I dream about all the time, of course.
Falling?
No, flying.
Oh, okay.
Falling. Falling's no
my
fun.
My superpower
I'm
is
saying, I dream about falling all the time.
No, I do too. But actually, not so much anymore. Actually, that's supposed to be a fear
oh, I'm sure.
One. The flying one is supposed to be more, you know, positive, actually. Have you ever heard that before?
No, because I'm scared to fly.
Oh.
Like,
you know,
so for me, that would be like the worst superpower ever.
Wait, are you're scared to fly in airplanes?
Well, I don't want to fly myself either. Like, I don't want to fly without an apparatus. That seems worse.
Wait, but are you afraid to fly in airplanes?
Yes, absolutely.
Me too. Oh, okay.
I have to have a special seat, and I'm the person at the airport, because Margie's always like, she's like, there's a baby. The minute, I'm always like, if there's an infant on the flight, I always ask to sit next to the infant. Now people are like, I don't want to sit next to the child. I don't want to sit next to any babies. Because I figure if something happens, God is not going to take that baby out. So I sit. The best flight I ever had, I had a nurse on one side and an infant, a newborn on the other. And whenever the mom had to go to the bathroom, I was like, I'll hold the baby. I held the baby. Margie and I went on an international flight to France. And this was very brave. This mom was flying by herself with like a 3-month-old. And you know, I mean, it was like, 10 hours. She had to use the bathroom and stuff. And literally, Margie's like, Cammie will hold the baby. And I was like in business class. I held the baby. I fed the baby. It was awesome. I'm super scared of flying. Oh. I have a special charm necklace that Chloe changed one of my... She emailed my publicist this morning and said, because I have a... We all at Little Brown have a travel document that will just say weird things like, if like Margie has 70,000 points on United, so she'll only fly United. So it says, like, Margie only flies United. She will connect 44 times if necessary. My travel document says, like, Cammie will not sleep in a room with a 13 on the door. She will not stay at the Waldorf Astoria as it has a 13th floor. And then Chloe came in my room really late last night, and she was like, I think there might be a problem with your tour. And I was like, what? Because I was thinking, what else? In fact, I'm not sleeping. What's the problem? But she was like, they have you on the plane, and I don't know if you're going to like your seat. And I was like, why? You know, am I on the aisle? Because I like to sit on the aisle, because I bet. He's like, no, you're in, like, 13, whatever. I was like, you can tell them right now I'm not getting on that plane. It's not going to happen. And I would have gotten off. Like, they would have been really unhappy, because I would have gotten off. So she emailed them and told them, and they're like, okay, we'll fix it. Because I was like, not only am I not even want to get on the plane in the first place, definitely not sitting in row 13, in seat 13C.
13.
No. I'd rather sit in, like, seat 666. Forget it. I'm so superstitious. Margie said there's no a lot of 666, so I just got my new passport right in the middle. It says 666, and I have to get a new passport. And I didn't notice until she pointed it out. Like, I would probably never have known. She was like, are you going to get a new passport? And I was like, why? Do I look ugly? She's like, no, but you know it says 666 right in the middle really big. And I was like, what? And you try to go explain to them that you need a new passport for that reason. Because they were like, they think you're going to sell your passport. Like, they were like, right, so you don't need a new passport. I said, I can't go out of the country. It was a 666.
Oh, you told them
the truth? Well, it was a Latin guy, and my husband's a Cuban. I mean, I think he understood.
Because
he was Catholic, too. I was like, I'm not doing it. Forget it. It's not happening.
I'm surprised that they did that. I'm surprised that that was possible.
Well, I said I could, like, shred it and do something damaging.
No, I mean,
I could sell my identity.
I'm surprised
then you have
there
to
wasn't some kind of computer program.
So. Oh, yeah. Like I said, you know, this should be on the list of numbers not to put in people's passports.
Yeah.
You know, like, so anyways, but I embrace all superstitions equally of every culture. That's why when people be like, have you ever heard? I'm like, no, please don't tell me. Like, I don't need to know anymore. I know so many now. And the Asian one threw me because apparently 13, I don't remember which country it is because Katie Allender told me this, 13 is unlucky in either China or Japan, but lucky in the other.
That's right.
So then I was like, what am I supposed to do with that?
Japan, it's unlucky because it's the word for death.
But why is it lucky in China then?
In China, it's not. Because China's very big on numbers.
I know, but lucky and neutral are different. How does it become from neutral to lucky?
Wearing green.
It would take all night to explain. But trust me, it's lucky in China.
Well, I think unfortunately there's too many countries that disagree, so I'm gonna have to go with the popular. 13 is bad.
I think you should just completely take 13 out of the equation.
Well, there is a video. I don't know if it's on my new YouTube channel. Knowing people who do my social media, the cruelty, it probably is. I went to this hotel in the South with Margie, and they put me in, like, I don't know, 1301 or something. Or no, it was something 13, because it wasn't on the 13th floor. It was, like, 113. So Margie's like, you should change your room. You're not going to sleep in there. I was like, I'm going to sleep in there. I'm totally going to sleep in there. Oh, it's Texas Book Festival. She's like, Kimmy, you're not going to sleep in there. It's, like, 1 in the morning. Just change your room. So I was like, no, I'm not changing my room. I'm going to stay in there. So I went in my room and I took this. I always make a big mess in my room. So I, like, unpacked all my stuff and I, like, took a video of myself and the door and how brave I was that I was staying in room 13. I put it up online. And then I was in the room for, like, 11 minutes. And I was like, I'm not going to be able to sleep in this room. And also, I looked out the window and there were these big metal. I mean, my stepdad was an undercover cop. In my world, they're called rape structures because rapists can climb up on them, like, stairs and climb into your window. And they were, I'm not kidding, they were big. They were some sort of generators and they looked exactly like a metal staircase. So then I was like, I definitely can't stand here now. So I went down in my pajamas and I told the guy who had on a purple suit with a little bit like he was from Oz. I said, I can stay in my room. And he said, what's wrong with your room? And I said, well, it's 1301. It's 113. I just want to have another room. He was like, I don't understand. I was like, my family's from the South. I can't stay in that room. And he was like, I don't understand. And the bellman seemed to get it. And I was like, it has a 13. And he was like, really? And I'm like, yeah, really. And I was like, and you have rape structures outside, by the way. And then I told him I made a video, and he said, did you say the name of the hotel? And I was like, no. And I was like, should I say the name of the hotel? And he's like, no, we're going to find you another room right away. And then, this was the best part. So they give me another room, and the bellman comes with me with the trolley, because I had so much junk, it was too impossible to repack. And I unlock the door and turn on light, and there's a man sleeping in the bed. Luckily, it was like a man, so, like, you know, he had a sheet on and probably his britches on. But I was like, oh, my God. So then I go downstairs, and the guy's like, do you have a problem with, you know, 22 also? And I was like, no, there's a man in my room. And he's like, no, there's no one in that room. And he, like, goes on the computer, there's no one in that room. And the bellman's like, there's totally someone in that room. So then I got this giant penthouse suite in the hotel. And then every morning at Texas Book Festival, they brought me waffles shaped like the state of Texas. It was awesome.
So now we all know to be really strange and picky, and then you'll get what you want.
I was going to stay in the second room. It was occupied. There was a guy in there. My husband would not have. I don't know. I was. I scared the crap out of me. I like turned on the light, and he was like, he was jumping, and I was and then I closed the door really fast. So I was like, can you imagine? Like, if someone now, I'm super paranoid now, since I'm worried someone's gonna come in my room when I'm sleeping. But he should have put the little chain thing, so I wouldn't come in.
Yes, I also have this thing that you buy that's an alarm when you go to a hotel, a woman by herself.
Oh, and you're making fun of me.
And you No, I have this thing. And you, it's like a little wedge, and you wedge it under the door, and if somebody were to open the door, this screech would go off. I'll try to send you the link for it.
It's my son would do that all the time at my house.
When you travel.
Yes, he would.
When you travel.
No, I'm saying my son would find that, and he would stick that under the door, so whenever you open the door, there would be a horrible sound.
Yes.
I have a daughter. Yes, he will.
Would your daughter do that, too?
Oh, yes, she would. Okay. She'd mod it. She'd make it, like, go, yeah, or something. She'd fix it up. She's an electronics freak.
I like that. Does anybody else have any questions? Your son books? We have to do the raffle, too.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so excited about the raffle. I'm hoping, like, that someone doesn't do it and then I get to win it.